has been a while. It's been a while since I've had anything worth being in a video. It's been a while since I've felt comfortable making one. My beard is becoming wizardly. My dreadlocks are coming along very nicely. Everything about the world is still crazy. Or wrong in some way. Or at least it seems like it. I think it might actually be right overall, that this is just a phase that it goes through. I think there's a lot more... let me backtrack that. See, trying to type any of the things I've been thinking lately has been an impossibility. It's something about reading versus hearing, typing versus speaking. They use completely different parts of your brain. And so, certain cognitive aspects seem to be tied to those parts. So, in a sense, this would be like, those who have eyes see, those who have ears hear. There were different statements and expressions for different modes of accepting ideas or information or data, for lack of a better term. So, the main part of my job pays nothing. Next, I make a bit. I make a significantly higher amount for the hourly work I do in a shop. And the thing is, I understand, due to the nature of the small local business, the way these things work, this ain't my first rodeo. Sometimes there are simply limits to what can be, unless a windfall occurs or some other boost in other ways. And when you're in the position of being the one that's the cheap one or whatever, that was when I was delivering pizza, it was the same way. It was that they kept their prices low, and in doing so they trapped themselves in a limit of how much they could make, but they kept an insane amount of business. Their argument was always about not wanting to go bigger because that would mean having to manage things at a different level and exist on a different tax bracket, which would change a lot of things, I think, financially. I don't think that is the case with my current employer, but... at the same time, we are the lower priced of the two competitors, and I don't know, it's like there's a limit to how much you can make, so I accept that, I get that, and I get that most of the people that part of the business is driving aren't going to tip, but it's like I'm waiting for some sort of abundance to come through the law of manifest generosity in other ways, and it doesn't necessarily mean through... you know, the same employer for the hourly, because it's like there's a limit to how much can be afforded to pay me for the time for the things that I'm doing, and I'm not wasting anybody's time, but there's only so much you can do. So, that's where I am. It's, I mean, you know, it's better than nothing on most levels, but at the same time, I also find myself looking at, for example, an intolerable manager. Not the owner, the owner's a sweetheart, but the manager is the owner's chosen manager, and this person does not function well. And because of that, it's difficult. It's not a matter of whether I'm doing anything right or wrong, whether, you know, anything of the sort. With it's just, this is a person who doesn't seem to know how to think straight, does things very arbitrarily because they feel like it, doesn't feel the need to justify it or attempt to when called out. It's just, you know, not stable and power tripping is basically what it is. And, you know, some days it's real easy, and some days it's like walking on eggshells, and I don't need that shit. At the start of it, I realized that the person doing the hiring, once I started working, I was like, this person is like my ex-mother-in-law. That's not okay. People are going to be like that, I get it. But, you know, it's just, I don't know, it's something very similar to gaslighting that goes on from a manager at work. There are things that go wrong with vehicles. I'm in a position of maintenance and observation and letting management and the owner specifically know what's going on with the vehicles. I think the owner's in the understanding that the reason everybody goes around the manager is because of the way the manager is, but she doesn't get rid of the manager. That's why you don't hire your friends. And... or was the friendship grown over the course of acquiring a manager position and all this other cushy shit? Who knows? So anyways, in and amongst this, driving around with people, there's a lot of really cool people, a lot of really good people that ride the cabs. And I don't fault any of them if they can't afford a tip. I don't fault anybody if they don't tip. I really don't on this one. It's a totally different angle than pizza delivery, and I've been over that. I put that on Facebook all the time. But you know, you're ordering your food and having it delivered is a luxury tip. That's some royalty shit. If you're gonna act like you're some kind of freaking monarch, then be a generous and good monarch to that freaking subject you just demanded deliver your food hot, ready, and exactly what you wanted, or you're not paying for it. And then there are other people that I think I've put into two categories. One is casualties of, I don't know what to call it, the cultural, everybody says cultural Marxism is a bad idea, but it is demoralization propaganda and cultural directedness that steers people's thinking in the way that they just are, and they don't even think about it. People are like, what culture? Dude, the culture is all the entertainment. The culture is all the things that society is into, talks about. That's the culture. At some points it was music. At some points it was theater. At some points it's whatever it is that social media generates. This seeming connectedness and at the same time isolation. But the thing is, there are casualties. There are people that have no clue. The asleep, right? And then there are shit people. Just people that suck. And your job is to get them where they need to go and fake happy cool about it. Or at least be quiet. The people that are good people are the ones that will know me as a very talkative and sarcastic guy. Not sarcastic in a mean way, but just, like, always have a good way of turning something into a joke. And, like, I try not to judge anyone. I try super ultra hard. I don't always succeed, and it sucks, because I go for a long time, and I do really well, and then I just reach a limit. So, yeah, I don't make money and don't particularly enjoy that aspect of the not making money part. The other part I like, but it's limited. I have no idea whether or not they are a co-exclusive deal. Whether if I find a way to cease driving, I don't mind the people. I kind of like the people that I work with. I don't mind being like their shop guy, keeping their stuff up and still talking to them and everything, but I don't want to leave them in the lurch. But at the same time, it's like 4 days a week minimum full-time shifts that I would be out if I was to not do this. But going back to the issue with the manager, like, I have an issue with this freaking manager, and I'm getting tired of being treated the way I'm being treated for no reason. It literally is just telling me that I'm wrong when I'm right, and I've reached a position of trust and acceptance within the rest of the people in the company that they value my judgment, and this person is just doing this, and it's like, I'm pretty sure it's because there's craziness going on and not because they're trying to be like this. But crazy is still intolerable because it gets in the way of good functioning. Add to this that pretty much the one thing that irritates me the most of ever, and it has pretty much always been like this because it's always been when you're the smart kid and you happen to be genetically predisposed to talkativeness, that you're saying things that are new and interesting and learning and trying to tell other people about these cool things. It's like when people get born again Christian and they just try and convert everyone around them. It's ego pushing out, share this knowledge. And on the other hand, in the learning process, if you are teaching or sharing knowledge with others, you are reinforcing it with yourself, both through a feedback loop of your senses, noticing you doing it, and cognitively because you're accessing it for output rather than input, the things you've learned. It's like learning it from forwards and backwards. So, when you're just trying to spread knowledge and be helpful, and someone tells you that you're wrong when you know that you're right, it's not like I speak on things I don't know about. Usually I'll say, I don't know about that, or I don't know anything yet, or I don't know. Like, there's all kinds of, like, acknowledgement that I don't know things when I don't know things. So when I am choosing to put out a true and factual thing based on, you know, some serious thought, especially when it comes to, like, automotive issues and, you know, things I've never done before but I'm working on solving a problem, this is, like, that part's right up my alley. It's the best freaking thing ever. It is manna for the brain. And the person that's supposed to be in charge is telling me I'm wrong when I'm right. Like, pretty much every issue on vehicles that have gone wrong, and I've driven it and been like, I can tell you what's wrong with this vehicle, and then what's her name says, I'm sorry, I meant to keep it on a completely neutral, not specific, this person, this intolerable manager with the instability, says, no, it isn't. And at this point, possibly due to health issues that I was unaware of, the owner was also like, yeah, I don't know. It finally got it in a situation to where the mechanic and the day shift driver, who does most of the managing but isn't paid to manage, have got, like, repair situations worked out. With the boss's permission, from what I'm told, that they just get this stuff done, and that way she doesn't have to bother with it. And it's like, cool, good, because I get it. She doesn't understand a lot about vehicles, and gets overburdened, she has other things she's doing, too, besides just that. And, but what it turns out is that every single time that the things that have been wrong that have been repaired were the things I said they were. So, anyone who knows me, knows me. They know that when I'm right, I'm right, and I know that I'm right. And I'm not going to say I'm right when I know that I'm not. Or if I don't know that if I am or not, I'll say I don't know. So, my bets have been correct. I really don't like it when I'm told that I'm wrong about things I know about. And it's just a continual thing, and it's almost random. And that's the thing that I really can't get around, is when you have a person that is in a position of management of a business, a boss of people, who has some sort of compulsive reactive disorder, this person needs to be on disability, working part-time, not managing a company 24/7. I guess it's like what, from a logical standpoint, that's what it is. That part makes zero sense. And the only thing, those things in place, I believe, is some sort of friendship deal. And it's like, okay, if that's not going to change, something else has got to. So, I don't know. I heard a rumor. I'm not repeating a rumor. If that rumor is true, it's possible I can get away from driving, if I'm even invited. But I don't know. I've been pretty fucking bipolar lately, so we'll see how, if I've been able to curb or pull the brakes enough on all this stuff coming out that I can't stop it, but I can try and alter it or slow it down. If those things have been enough to prevent me from completely fucking myself out of anything, you know, improving. Because I sure as fuck know that if I just let it fly all the time, it will not improve anything either. So, that felt good to get out. I hold a lot of stuff in. I don't have anyone really to talk to, and I'm not going to say this shit to my cats. They pick up on tone of voice. They're going to be like, oh, you're irritated and agitated. What did we do? Should we be irritated and agitated too? I do get to see a lot of cats and dogs, although I don't get to pet them. But they're there. Driving around on nice days is great, even if the days aren't nice, it's cool. If the weather's real shitty, they close. I don't mind that. But 12-hour days, not getting tipped by some bum-ass motherfuckers, and a manager who I think is crazy, is like half of my job. I don't know if that's supposed to be appropriate. Is this hell, right? But yeah, so that's the situation. I'm not complaining about you. I'm complaining about that person. But I am making do. And then some. And I don't know. I think worst come to worst, the next step is doggy daycare. Or something similar. I think that's probably good way to make some money without, there's going to be irritating owners, but then there's going to be dogs and maybe cats. Yeah, I think that about covers it. Call this a channel update, I guess. Final thoughts. Hopefully this isn't turning into freaking 45 minutes because we're not quite to 20. Oh yeah, there was another thing. When I do have my mood swings, I reflect on the delusions that come about during certain parts of it. They come on the ups and the downs. It's not just mania that brings delusion. There's a lot of weird stuff about the denial aspect that I don't personally have to deal with. And it's hard to explain. So, but the gist being that I will reflect on the things that my delusions insist after the fact and compare them and fact check them and get to what things were legitimate irritations. Basically, it's like dysphoria is a kind of delusion. So, like, I'll look at all my dysphorias as well as all my euphorias, and I will compare facts on things or whatever and eliminate, you know, file off the, yep, those are the things that aren't true. Okay, here's the legit. You know, these are the things I had a right to be pissed about. They weren't just some bullshit. So I do this all the time. Every time I'm like, okay, wait, I obviously just had a mood swing. Things feel different. You know, and I'll review. When the stress level gets high enough on any given, you know, metric of how my mind, you know, is, if a stress or concern gets to be too high, then I do end up getting mood swings of some sort. You know, otherwise, normally I don't notice them. I'm able to kind of meet the effects through self-control. That ultimately is what it comes to, is like there's an adult who should be exercising self-control who just doesn't seem to be able to. I feel like that person is not worthy of being a manager. Seems like I'm all over the place, but I'm only going to talk about like two or three things here. So the real final note, scraped the bottom of the barrel on the last one, got everything out, I think. I noticed the swell of what I consider to be magic yesterday. And this, it's a perception difference, something's different kind of thing. I'm wondering about an entire month of ancient and very high magic between full moons, or even the wizard's moons, which means that there's an extension there. And what happens to that on the new moon, if it'll be interesting to, you know, see if I'm able to observe for long enough to, if this perceptive difference remains, I can see how it affects things or how it is affected. But the springtime on the magical level is always potent. If you develop sensitivity to those things, you notice it. And the Easter season's coming. So, and whatever else is, or other else, whatever other, that's the word I'm looking for, holidays or significances during the time that coincide, some of them involve magic, and so it's interesting to note as it swells in the spring. Could also, for that matter, be some sort of a tidal thing manifesting as a perceptive alteration without a specific noticeable thing being different. It's kind of the same as how you notice mood swings. Only distinctly different from a mood swing. So I think that's about it. It's not safe to cast magic until at least May, and I haven't personally since the summer, because of a couple of very noticeable things on, unfortunately, videos that had to be privated in haste, however, which still exists, but I'm not sure that the original upload date would remain in the description when removed from private, but there is a two-part video on magic ritual that definitely coincided with a significant event. So anyways, yeah, I've just basically been observing and not practicing. In some of my traveling about town, there are a few people that I'm keeping interesting conversations with, including specific magic things, because they have questions they can ask me. So that's an interesting aspect of it as well. But it's so rare and infrequent that those things happen like that. So anyways, yeah, it's an interesting time to be alive. It is an interesting time to watch the world, to live, to do the thing, all the things. Doesn't mean it's easy. It's definitely interesting, though. So yeah, as far as the craziness of others goes, I'm not saying this based on having viewed propaganda, I'm saying this based on what I'm seeing in people through a fairly interesting selection and cross-section depending on what day and what time, because there are regulars and there are randoms, but just in how people are, the things they mention, how they react to certain other things, you can tell with people. There are some, not very many, but some, who are indelibly ruined. And then there are people that I think are not quite to that point. But as I said previously, there are casualties of the culture. And they are doing exactly what they want them to do. The they. Can't just wake them. That thing morph is true. And anything you can do to broaden their awareness individually fades. So, as far as the rescue of conscious humanity goes, it's much like the idea of a pandemic virus, that it's entirely possible it may not be contained properly ever, and it may not get to everyone, but it may ruin a lot of shit for everyone. So, I guess we'll leave it at that. The last word being, do not, under any circumstance, panic. Don't panic.